Let's move on to the last panel for the day on the digital marketing state of affairs and what's next. Let's have a huge round of applause for our panelists here in tow. The panel will be chaired by Neil Pandya, CEO, APAC, Pi6One, followed by our panelists here, Mr. Karan Rajpal, Head of Digital Marketing, Dalmia Cement, Ms. Ashima Kakkar, Head Marketing, NLB Technologies, Ms. Archana Agarwal, VP, Media, Airtel. Let's welcome all the eminent personalities with a huge round of applause, please. Everybody, please put your hands up in the air. Thank you once again to all of you for taking out your precious time. Over to Neil, sir, here. Thank you.
Thank you. Okay, firstly, thank you, E4M. I think it's really, really awesome to see everyone in person, put faces to the name. I believe that, you know, digital has an illusion in all of us that in Zoom calls, we show only upper half and we don't. I have taken digital as really, pandemic has affected me, health and a lot of other stuff I've not considered really bad. But when I see Rajiv, who is fit and fine right now with me, gives me some intentions that illusions and we need to move out of that. Guys, today we're going to talk about digital marketing and state of affairs. I think there is a lot which has changed in pandemic, and we have done hundreds of webinars and seminars talking about that thing. So we will speak something about the obvious changes into digital marketing, which were maybe AI, maybe augmented reality, maybe adoption of digital, maybe acceleration of digital into 5X, all of these, all of such stuff which we have spoken. But today we'll try and see if we can cover something new as well. Let me rather not waste any further time. And you know, before we start, I think I have one simple question to all of you guys. We have defined digital marketing multiple times. So if you have to define digital marketing in your style, I mean, Karan, in your experience, if you have to define, not the bookish knowledge or the theoretical knowledge, how would you do it? I can start from anyone.
So I think marketing before digital marketing, the shortest and the clearest definition that stuck by me is marketing is the truth well told. And digital marketing is the opportunity to tell that truth over and over again until your truth becomes your consumer's truth as well.
Ashima, any interesting facts about digital marketing?
So I think digital to me is a way of life. And I think the brands, for brands, it's become a way of life. For all of us, it's become a way of life. And I think digital to me is observation. And to me, that translates into campaigns, that translates into ideas. So that's digital to me.
Telecom is always ahead in digital marketing. Anything new from personal and professional?
For me, digital, it's a black box, it's walled gardens, it's future tech, it's where the consumers are going to be in the future, it's entertainment, it's a lot of things. So, I mean, I'm looking at both from a consumer and a marketer's standpoint, because if a marketer doesn't understand what the consumer is looking for, how do we plan strategies around it?
Rajiv, sir.
Hello. Yeah. I think, you know, this is something which everybody can do, you know. Marketing is something, you know, for which you have to go to business school and, you know, work in some fancy companies, wear nice suits like yours and mine, right? And talk some fancy jargons. This is something which can be done by everybody. And anybody who's a little bit savvy in technology, understands digital a bit, even if it doesn't understand. If you know and if you want to do business, you can start doing business. You can start doing business very, very quickly and enhance the business very, very quickly. That's what I think about digital marketing. That's the biggest difference which is there in the real world in this.
I think brilliantly said. I think, Rajiv, I completely agree. On a personal, for me, I think digital marketing at a personal level was my mom and dad adopting banking apps and doing transaction online. I think we never imagined. I think net banking was among youngsters or maybe 35, 40 year olds, but going to elderly people also, that was personal level of achievement in digital marketing. And I also believe, as Rajiv rightly said, digital marketing for being on L'Oreal's side when on the previous version, I think purchasing lipstick online with AI put into a structure or with artificial intelligence put into structure, I think that was the level at which digital marketing has gone. So superb, I think That's a very nice definition of digital marketing in your own respective industries. We have an interesting panel, guys, today. I think we have someone from Dalmia Cement who has moved into digital marketing over the years and now are a pro in digital marketing as per current right now. We have telecom industry Archana from Airtel, who has been, we have been learning digital marketing from telecoms in India. I think for years, telecom and e-commerce guys were doing the digital marketing. Ashima, I think, works for an organization who has brilliant digital transformation taking forward. And Rajiv, I think, I'll start with Rajiv, I'm ending with Rajiv. But Rajiv, I think, as a personal believer into Dabur as a brand over the years, I have seen Dabur ads into televisions from the years. But if you see recently, Dabur has moved modernized advertising. That's my perception. You can tell more about it. But as you would have moved into more modernized advertising, has your thinking into digital marketing has also changed? Is it that elderly audience moved into digital, or you are switching gears into youngsters and hence you're targeting digital marketing on youngsters? What's your say on that?
I think, first of all, everyone is on digital, right? So even your and my grandmoms and parents and everybody's there. Even, you know, if you go to rural areas and if you talk to people and ask them how do they watch TV, they'll tell you they don't watch TV. But you know, they will have a smartphone and ask them what do, and they say that this is a lal rang ka button, hai, isko daba dete hain. So isme se kuch chalne lagta hai. That's where they watch movies, which is like YouTube, right? So that's what has been. I mean, for people of this country, everybody is consuming digital and you can't be away from it. And as far as we are concerned, what we look at is that, you know, we look at the trends into context, into marketing, basically. That's how the journey is. And you look at the trends, you get the right context, and you basically market it to people. And that's how our journey starts and ends, actually.
Any specific trend Dabur would have picked up and you would have, taken advantage of that trend for Dabur as a brand?
Several of them, like for example, I'll give you an example of a brand called Dabur Honey, for example, right? Dabur Honey is a brand which used to be about 33% market share brand just about 3 years back, 4 years back. Now we are sitting at 55% market share currently. And it's been possible because we learned from people, we did a lot of social listening, we understood from the market what's important for people. And we figured out that, you know, what's important for people is that, you know, we should tell people that how is honey sourced. And we did a lot of content around sourcing. We created a lot of content around sourcing. We did a lot of content around purity of the honey product as a product. And it was a success. It was a success that, you know, it wiped away the competition completely. You know? That's one good example.
Interesting. I think moving from B2C, I think we have seen within B2C a lot of FMCG has done a lot of digital marketing. Karan, if I have to ask you this one, you are, thank you, Raj, you are more of a B2B and very less of a B2C. That's a safe assumption I've taken, but you can correct me if I'm wrong. How is digital marketing seeing a different side of an angle when it is B2B largely, or B2B2C to some extent? What is your perspective? What are the learnings?
So cement is about 85% B2C, where the cement is consumed by the consumer. But a lot of the sales to that segment happens through what were called influencers in the earlier era, not social media influencers, but people who are masons, contractors, head masons, and our channel partners, people who sell cement for a living out of their shops. To each of these people, digital marketing is still catching up. This is the cohort which I think we will reach last due to socioeconomic educational reasons. But what is happening is across the entire consumption cycle, whatever it is that you're buying, today it is almost natural and normal behavior to look for it online, even if you can or cannot purchase it. How do you make the consumer understand something about your product in the 2 minutes that you have with him? Cement is a very, very low involvement product. You know, there's a fair chance nobody in this room today would have thought about cement ever except for the 10 minutes they were asked to buy cement for building their home. How do you use that time? How do you make it simpler and easier for a customer? And for me, you know, it can be as simple as saying the customer having to visit six different outlets trying to understand what cement to buy, or, you know, having a very confusing conversation with their contractor. who may have, and you know, the dealer who may have other incentives. How do I basically capture that entire funnel, bring him into my fold? That you know, really makes a difference. Cement is not sold online. It's not an e-commerce or even a direct-to-consumer business today. But outside of the sales, what parts from the awareness to the consumption cycle, which for many brands can be years, but for my brand is minutes. Mujhe cement lena hai aur maine cement khareed liya. You know, that journey can be as little as 2 hours. What difference can I make in that moment? That really brings in the difference. Secondly, over the past 2 years, you know, digital was a good thing to do for many, many people. But there were at least two elongated periods in the last 2 years because of the pandemic where people could not get out. So a lot of these people are now getting online and saying, "Acha, ja nahi sakte, dekhte hain agar online kuch milta hai." How do you make that journey simpler for them? So, you know, my thing is not, you know, how easy I can make the purchase process. My thing is, from the moment a consumer has thought they need to buy cement, how quickly can my person reach out to them and aid their buying? And if I can do that well, and if that is something I can improve on over time, that I think is the short-term goal for me. And then as the market matures, as consumers mature, we will see that. But just one last point, you know, people buying cement by themselves largely happens in what we would call typically tier 3 cities, B centers, so on and so forth. People like us, we would either be living in a, you know, flat which is constructed by a builder, or we would be living in a condo, again, which is in the B2B segment. This segment, you know, what growth we can make, vernacular, tier 3 centers, people for whom mobile is really the internet. How do we get into those stratas? That is the real thing that we're working on now.
Fairly interesting. I don't think so. There will be a time. Sooner we will see cements getting sold on Amazon as well. And that's where your consumers, either in tier 3 or tier 1 or tier 2, who are searching that perspective, but the D2C model can be greatly replicated. Ashima, for you, I think you've worked your career into Tech Mahindra earlier, which was one of the pioneers into digital marketing as well. And today at NLB itself, which is a digital transformation organization, what are your current learnings or the past learnings into the overall digital marketing as an affair? If you can highlight some of them, would be interesting.
Sure. So I think for me, the most interesting understanding over the last 1 month of the transition that I've had from Tech Mahindra to NLB, Tech Mahindra, which was a $5 billion company, and NLB, which is a $500 million company. The sensitivity to digital is far more. And I think it's the emerging businesses that are acclimatizing themselves to the need of digital far more quicker. I think it is also owing to the young, new age entrepreneurship, because they live in a digital age. Therefore, they understand the givings of the platform much more easier. Also, I think the whole dynamic of the industry is also changing. And I think last 2 years, all of us marketers who thought, you know, do events, get leads and come back home, we've all realized that this is not going to fix it. And therefore, the need to be able to reach out to a customer in the most relevant way. And I think that's true for consumer companies such as Dabur, and it's true for B2B companies such as myself, that a consumer today is looking for information at all times. It just so happens, are you being able to give that information at the right time? And if you are not, you're losing an opportunity. So therefore, the responsibility is to be able to, so just before we entered the room, there was a conversation on, is content important or is channel important? I think one can't exist without the other. That's my take. And the general phenomena is, and I say this, you know, so when I joined NLB, their main business is in staffing solutions. For the life of me, I didn't know that there were 14,000 skill assessment platforms. And that's how huge the market is. And that's how diversified the market is for any sphere of life you touch today. If you want to get hired, there's a platform. If you want to get fired, there's a platform. And Twitter is most likely it. So that's my take.
Very interesting. I think hiring, there are a lot of people in the room also want to look at hiring into a tech platform. NLB can help you on those lines as well. Archana, coming to you, I think you are the one who is handling a lot of $1 million in media, digital media for Airtel. There are multiple things. I mean, a lot of us are moving into digital. There is a differentiation where people want to move into digital marketing and people know digital marketing or maybe digital media. I'm sure you would also would have come across within your team that yaar TV nahi karte hum digital karte hain. Ya fir digital kyu karna hai? In such scenarios, how do you answer to those such questions, and how, in absence of a third party attribution model into digital spends, you, when you are spending so much on digital marketing, how do you define ROI from perspective?
There's always this constant debate between whether we should do television or digital or a mix of both, and why should we do digital, brand digital, which is driving top funnel metrics, because at the end of it, most marketeers or brands are interested in finally saying, how many leads did I get, how many acquisitions did I make? So it's always, should we shift all our budgets to performance? But I think over time, you know, with all the experiments we've done, I think over time, everybody, at least now in the company, started realizing the value of doing brand digital in conjunction with performance. And everything goes hand in hand, right? We can't do one aspect and not do other things, right? So we've also got into advocacy and influencer marketing. We have a command center where we do social listening, right? We've got into some bits, not exactly long form, but content integration on digital. When you see, how do you see results? Fortunately, because we are telecom, you know, we, unlike FMCGs where you have to wait for 1 month later, you'll get the market share and all of that data, and then you know whether the campaign has worked. Here I can get to know practically on a daily, weekly basis, because there is a CTA which is given. The CTA is either driving traffic. I mean, when I joined Airtel, it used to be a call center, so the CTA used to be a number. So you knew how many calls were coming to the call center on a daily basis, and you knew that whether people, if people are calling to inquire about your product, that means somewhere the campaign's working. Now you can see there's a CTA which drives traffic to the website or to the app. You automatically get to understand what's, if it's working. Now the other most important thing is also looking at consumer journeys while you're building a digital campaign, right? Or any campaign as well. But more so on digital, because it's a direct click, right? And that click has to lead to a certain landing page. I think last year, a lot of effort and work went into driving these consumer journeys and creating these consumer journeys to make them more efficient for consumers and making it more easy. Then we did a lot more, we've introduced a lot of things in the last 1 year in terms of like self-care, like, you know, if you go, you can chat and understand. And we also track to seeing how many, what percentage of our consumers are calling the call center, how many are going to the app directly. So I think we're building pieces of the understanding of what's working and what's not, right? Because everything finally has to, you're right, there is no, you know, the attribution metric is woefully kind of absent, and everybody follows the last click attribution. I'm not so sure it's because the advertisers want to follow that, or it's because the way the industry is built. Okay, because the industry is like, how do I pay a platform based on saying that no, actually, while the click came from you and the acquisition came from you, but there are 10 other platforms which actually help drive that awareness, consideration, and then the interest, and then finally the actual purchase, right? So till the industry evolves to actually coming together on a platform saying this is the attribution models we should follow, and it could be very different for every different industries, I think we'll still continue following the last click attribution model. But I think from a ROI standpoint, these are things that we look at. We look, and then we do a lot more brand lift studies, we do some MMMs, and now we are recently investing into, we're doing lots of work in terms of platform, understanding the reach of our campaigns on digital purely, reach curves. Then we still haven't got the final reports, but we've done some pilots with the Google's ADH, which is the Ads Data Hub, to understand a lot of things in terms of how, what's the right frequency. So all of this is we can't do this manually. It requires a lot of automation, and that's where we're looking. We are exploring new tools. One, I think, is your company, which we're exploring. Then there is the other tool which we're exploring is Copilot and Skibids and various other tools like this, which actually This year, our focus has been purely on understanding how can we enhance our understanding on digital and improve our marketing ROI, be it efficiency or be it effectiveness. Because when you're looking at brand campaigns, while efficiency is important, the effectiveness is more critical. While for the lower end performance campaigns, your efficiency in terms of my lowest cost per acquisition becomes important. So, you know, we have to figure out between the two metrics as to which, where do we focus on more the effectiveness part and where we are focusing on the efficiency part.
I think damn interesting. I think anyone who's heard in this room a crash course in 5 minutes about digital marketing, that was the answer. I think she's mentioned everything what a marketer or a digital marketer would want to do on a day-to-day basis. So thank you, Archana, for that. Having said that, I think it intrigued me with Archana saying a lot of new words like advocacy, influencer marketing, maybe last click, and a lot of other stuff. This question is open to all of you guys. One, so let me frame the question in a way, a 70-20-10 rule. I mean, 70% of the money, time, effort, we do into the regular things, some ad kharite, Google, Facebook, sabke upar. 20% we may invest into impact, like cricket, IPL, something like. But 10% of the money, time, effort, we would want to invest into something which is really new and never done before, maybe innovation. So in your respective organization, one 10% in history, whenever you would have done it, and how do you feel that has worked? It could be anything. It could be influencer marketing which has worked for you or anything. Anyone gets it. Karan, I will again. I think Rajiv, I should go with you this time because I'm just following the path.
Right. I think one important part has always been influencer marketing. You know, so that what we have done is that, you know, we have since we sell across the country and all the geographies, there are like hundreds of brands to sell, and you know, so we have come up with a structure, regional structure, in which we have regional marketing managers. And so we recruit influencers from the local markets, and we do that very, very locally. And we have on our panel, we'll probably have one of the highest number of influencers any company would work with, you know. I think in this country, as many number of people who are there on LinkedIn would be on as influencers also, right? As many influencers in the country. So lots of influencers. Then new things like connected TV, etc. Micro-targeting
you have to pick one which has worked for you in the last 6 months. What would be?
So in companies like us, one thing doesn't work. A combination of several things work, you know. And it's very difficult to attribute success to one person or one reason. So everything works together, you know. So
brilliant,
very difficult to say that.
I give this answer every time, which has been asked from my bosses earlier, that kya chala mujhe batao.
Ye nahi kar sakte, maine kiya, meri vajah se, nothing like that.
Superb. Karan, for you.
So, I think I have a very interesting answer about the 10% that you asked. For confidentiality reasons, I can't disclose it fully. But, so cement, like I said, it's an age-old industry. Frankly, all of the brands have been sleeping at the wheel when it comes to digital. Of course, the last 1.5 years, because I've been here for 3 years, I know exactly what the before was and what the during is now. Everybody started with spending a lot on Google search, right? Search ads, they're one of the largest drivers of commerce in India on the online ecosystem. Over a period of time, I realized that just below the ad, it wasn't actually the brands themselves which were owning all the keyword results, you know, all page one. They were owned by this aggregator, right? And there was a solution available with this aggregator, literally pennies on the dollar when it compares to search ads. And you know, I have run it fairly successfully over the past 2 years now. Pure commercial value to be able to show that in a business where digital doesn't really give away, you know, saying that this was what my cost per lead was or this is what my overall consumption was. But to be able to do that, I think what is more important is the ability of the business's management, regardless of their orientation. You know, I come from a business which is older than this country's independence. And the product is sold today the same way it was sold 70 years ago. For the business to say that, yes, I will jump into this with you and we will see what happens. That, I think, is what makes the 10% available. you know, stunts are, in digital especially, stunts are dime a dozen. You know, every day you have somebody coming to you and pitching something new. Your ability to be, you know, see what is the commercial value of this at the end of the day is what is important. The thing that I think has been missing for many people in finding this 10% is everybody is trying to monetize their own network rather than saying, how will my network reach out to your customer in a newer way? You know, I can show your ad, I can send an SMS on your behalf, I can run a video on my platform because people are consuming something, that is one. And now I am, you know, now my next 10% is something even more interesting, which is what is being called these days as zero-click results. So how do I basically pick up, say, search snippets, pick up maps, and all the other things that are available there, and drive business through it? As long as, you know, we continue to be in that same sphere of, is 70% mein kuch naya 10% dhoondte hain, we continue to be in that thing, and then, you know, what Rajiv was just saying, it's a combination of things. There is a way out of that. It's more a function of the business you're in, and it's more a function of your understanding of that ecosystem.
Very fair. I think if I have to say 10%, you rightly pointed about that you need to move away as a seller what you're going to the customer as. I think don't go with inventory selling, don't go with impact selling, go with a solution selling to the clients and the brands. I think that's where that 10% will really come into picture. Ashima, in your entire experience, that one thing which you feel it falls into that 10% and is innovative.
So before taking that on, I think, you know, as marketeers, the whole conversation on tools is so fascinating and also somewhat digressing in our daily lives, you know, because somebody will come up and say, there's a new tool, let's try it out, without understanding whether it's needed in our ecosystem or not. So in the quest of appearing cool, you know, we look at platforms without realizing what is the purpose it's serving me. And I think that's something every marketer needs to be wary of. But like Rajiv said, there's not one medicine that works. It's usually a concoction, and current times has proven that. So I think personally, I was, we all know World Economic Forum, Davos is a very high cost platform. As a marketer, if you have to do any sort of branding at Davos, it's going to cost you an arm and a leg. And when you're up against brands that have just $1 billion budget for that particular year, time of the year, and we worked on a very, very different model, so coupled with programmatic and geofencing. And I think that was my first experiment with geofencing. And I always thought it's something that is cool for local brands to do in terms of geofencing. Okay, I'm a local restaurant, let me do geofencing. But to understand how, as a B2B brand, I was able to drive conversation is something that, I mean, I think I'd love to talk about as a case study sometime in my career. But I think the fact that geofencing coupled with programmatic gave me the same traction $1 billion brand was getting in less than 200K.
And I think, Ashima, in the same point, I again agree with you from a perspective that Rajiv, you've spoiled the answers for everyone else, because, you know, from a perspective of picking one, everyone is going on to and picking all three and all of them. But I agree to your respective answer, what you said. Archana, one thing, I'm rephrasing the question, not one thing which has only worked, but one of the things which have worked for you as an innovation.
Okay, first I want to say, while it takes 10% money, it takes much more effort. So the effort is not 10%, the effort is actually 30, 40, maybe 50%, right? Because any new platform or anything new, you require a lot more effort put in to understand it and how it fits in with, as you were mentioning, Ashima, that how does it fit into your brand, right? How everything doesn't need to necessarily work, right? I would rather talk about stuff which we've done recently and what we feel intuitively has worked in the last few months that we've been investing in. The fact is, different things work for different audiences. So let me bring that up first, right? We've been doing a lot of connected television because we believe that's where the future is, right? And I'm preempting some other questions in case you have, but I feel that future, today a lot of audiences are moving towards connected televisions. And a lot of work in that space is yet to be done. But we've already started working in it. In fact, just before this, I was having a meeting with one of our partners, and the question, I was like, I want to understand, did I get brand lift from just these connected TV users, right? We didn't get the answer, but the fact is that those are the questions that at least at Airtel, we are already asking our partners, saying, this is what we want to understand. Because the base work, there is enough stuff we are doing through Nielsen Dahl and various other platforms to understand. And as I said, you look at the regular metrics. But these are the new things, which are the ones which are the future. And that's what I would like to focus on. So programmatic could become very big in future. There are a lot of platforms who come up with as programmatic platforms. And some of them seem very interesting. I think the other piece which we are working on is the whole B2B space, because we at Airtel, we have a vertical which is B2B. And that was again a completely new platform or a new product for us to advertise. And what worked in that, you know, so every platform or every campaign is different, every consumer is different, but I think for future I'm looking at, you know, CTVs and programmatic being big. Anything which is a lot more tech enabled.
Thank you. Archana, I think thank you. We have just 45 seconds. So taking Archana's perspective only, so I think we all spoke about 2020, 2021, 2019. We are sitting in November right now, and let's talk about 2022. And one tech or one new thing which you feel in 2022 would really stand out for marketers to look out for, as she rightly mentioned, connected TV was one of the things. Is there anything, one, you are looking at your respective organization, or in general, you feel the industry is moving into that direction in 2022?
I think the two things which will get talked about a lot next year is Metaverse. I think everybody will have, and probably Exchange of Media will have a conference of Metaverse around the same time next year, you know. And that's one. And obviously, you know, I mean, for companies like, I think all of us, you know, I mean, targeting is very, very important. So sharp targeting, tools which can give you sharp targeting, be it programmatic tools or something like this, and the most important thing is transparency. Programmatic doesn't bring so much transparency. We need transparency. So these things will be very, very important for us, I think.
So I will just do a selfish answer to that. Transparency plus programmatic plus targeting is equal to Pixis One. Sorry, guys. Karan, one thing from you.
So for me, I think next year will be the year of boiling over of a lot of things that have been building in the ecosystem for the past few years. So if we quickly look at it, one thing that's been boiling over is the number of influencers. So two things will happen. One is a larger set of what one can very confidently call tier one influencers will rise up. We will see, not from the branded content perspective, but from the influencer's own personality perspective, things coming up. Could be their own content. Bhuvan Bam's doing his TV series now. So a lot of these things are already in play. So when you have these influencers, what is the logical next step? So I think social commerce is one thing that has not happened in India yet. It's very, very big on a standalone basis in the States. It's humongous in China in the last 6 to 9 months. Social commerce becomes the one thing where your influencers basically at its you know, naked best, peddling things to you, and you can buy it there and then. The second, I think, will be around the quick commerce space. What can I get to you in the next 45 minutes? And the brand that is available on that platform and the brand that brings it to you will walk away with all the premium that the market is ready to pay for convenience. So that entire premium around convenience, so it will change from hame wo cheez khareedni hai, acha main market jaunga to dekhunga, to hame wo cheez khareedni hai, acha manga ke dekhte hain kaisi hai. I think that switch, we're right and ready for it, at least for the 70 odd million people who transact digitally on an everyday basis. So these two for me.
Very well said. Ashima, last two takes on this.
So I think as a B2B brand, one thing that I'm very, very excited about is the no-click searches. I think it's going to get much more powerful as we go along. And I think if a brand is seriously thinking about this sphere, they need to address it. As a B2C, I think the in-post shopping is something that's going to catch up massively. And I think brands, B2C brands really need to gear up for that.
Okay, so damn interesting, guys. We have taken 3 minutes more. So from perspective, guys, 2022, if you hear marketeers from B2C to B2B, there is transparency and targeting, which Rajiv is looking at. There is, Karan is definitely sure social commerce is going to go really big in-store, in-banner shopping, is what Ashima is looking at. And Archana has rightly told us a lot about connected TVs and what is going to benefit. So that is what 2022 looks for all of us, guys. And have a fabulous day, guys. Be safe. Thank you so much, guys, for being.
That was quite an insightful session. Can we have a huge round of applause for all the panelists here on board with us? I would request all of you to stay back. I would humbly like to call upon Mr. Rohail Raman, Senior Editor, Exchange for Media, to kindly do the honors of presenting mementos to all the dignitaries here on the DS with us. Starting with the chair for the session, Mr. Neil Pandya. So please accept this token of appreciation from our end. Everybody, can we have a huge round of applause, please? Thank you. Next we have Mr. Karan Rajpal. Okay. Once again, thank you to all the dignitaries here for your precious time here today. Thank you, ma'am. Last but not the least, please accept this token of appreciation from our end. A humble request to all of you for a photo op session here. A group picture, please. Thank you.